What happens if we have a bead in an off-center rotating hoop? The left-right symmetry is broken. Seen in the front, the hoop would look like that. This has left-right symmetry. Now we're going to off-center by some amount, epsilon. What will happen to the bifurcation diagram? We talked about this a little bit before when we discussed the bifurcations and their robustness. For epsilon equals zero, omega, angular velocity with which we rotate the hoop. And then this is the location of the equilibrium points in terms of theta, where down is theta equals zero. We had before that there was a, it was stable until we reached omega critical, some critical value, and then that became unstable, and there were two branches of stable points coming out in a pitchfork bifurcation. But as we've discussed before, this is a fragile situation because it requires epsilon equals zero. So any small imperfection, they might call it, if we could refer to epsilon as an imperfection parameter or a symmetry breaking parameter, we just say epsilon not equal to zero. You could be offset to the right or to the left, and then so something will happen here. We have an idea from our earlier discussion. The stable point that's at the bottom will just sort of veer out of the way, go somewhere, and then out of seemingly nowhere, there'll be a saddle node bifurcation. Over here, this is the omega critical at epsilon zero. Here is omega critical for a non-zero epsilon saddle node bifurcation. And this leads into a discussion that kind of continues that idea of the robustness of bifurcations, but discusses it in a different sense because now you have a bifurcation that depends on two parameters. So there's more that could be said in particular about this pitchfork bifurcation. So this leads to what are called imperfect bifurcations and something called the cusp catastrophe. This is in section 3.6 of Strogatz. So it's a different point of view on looking at the same normal form from before, but I'll follow the terminology of the book. So the normal form for the pitchfork bifurcation was that thing with a cubic, had a linear and a cubic, rx plus x cubed. But now we will add on, instead of epsilon, I'm going to call it h, following what the book does, because this breaks the symmetry. H is called an imperfection parameter. Nothing's perfect. Whatever this is, it's a bifurcation that depends on two parameters, r and now h. Sometimes we'll look at if we were to keep one of the parameters fixed, like r and vary h, or if we were to fix h and vary r, which is what we initially looked at, but you can look at both. This is harder to analyze in detail. Last time I just qualitatively showed you, said, oh, this is what happens. If we want to find where the fixed points are, so find the fixed points, that would be where x dot equals zero. So we could use a graphical method. I mean, we could solve this cubic, I guess. It's a cubic in x. Or we could use a graphical method. It would be the intersection of two graphs, y equals rx plus, or sorry, I put positive here. This should be negative. Sorry about that. Negative. Negative x cubed and y equals negative h. Where these two meet, you would have the right-hand side up here equaling zero. So we'll plot those two. We can look first at the case of r less than or equal to zero. I'm looking for fixed points, so that means I'm looking for the points x star that are at the intersection. So I might write this as x star. And for r less than or equal to zero, what I get for the first curve, we'll do that in red, is something like this. It's cubic, symmetric. And this other curve, I'm doing blue, negative h. So if I have, let's just suppose h is negative, so I could put something above the line. So here is y equals negative h, and this red thing is y equals rx minus x cubed. So we see that for this case, even as we vary h, that just is going to change where this horizontal line is. And so we're only going to get one point. So there's only one fixed point when r is less than or equal to zero. So let's maybe plot that point. Actually, what am I plotting here? Yeah, sorry. This is, I'm doing something wrong. This is x, and we're just plotting two curves. Y is just sort of a dummy variable. So this point where the two intersect, there's just one intersection point. So that means only one fixed point. But what about when r is greater than zero? That red curve, the cubic, changes, right? It becomes now more interesting looking. Generally get something that looks like that. And you can see that as we vary where that horizontal line is, we're going to get different numbers of intersection points. Let's say we're down here plotting the magnitude of h is less than some critical value. We'd get 3 points. There'd be 3 points of intersection, so 3 equilibria. As we vary that, changing the magnitude, if we go by h critical, just touching the top of this hump of the red curve. So this would be magnitude of h equals the critical value. And so that would be an intersection in just 2 points. And as I increase the magnitude of h further, I'm back to this scenario where we're just getting it and intersecting in 1 point. So we can get 1, 2, or 3 intersections, meaning 1, 2, or 3 fixed points from this normal form, depending on the value of h. That critical case occurs when the horizontal line is just tangent to either the local minimum or the local maximum. I'm plotting just magnitude of h. So that occurs when we're tangent to that point, and that's going to be a saddle node bifurcation. To find the values of h where this bifurcation occurs, we note that the cubic has a local maximum. We're focusing on the r greater than zero case. The red curve has a local maximum where we've got the derivative of that red curve, rx minus x cubed, where that derivative equals zero. So where that happens. And what is this? If we take that derivative, we get r minus 3x squared equals zero. So x squared equals what? R over 3. So just take the square root of both sides and we'll call that x max. So this is x max. By symmetry, this is negative x max over here. And then what is the value of the cubic? So what is the height y of x max? Just put it in there. And we'll work out, right, this is r x max minus x max cubed. And you work that out, you get 2r over 3 square root r over 3. That's the height that we're going to call critical hc. And so notice that hc is a function of r. So maybe over here, if I was to be a little bit more careful, I'd say, well, this is a function of r, this is a function of r, this is a function of r. That's nice. We've got an explicit formula for this. If we were to summarize our results so far, looking at the case r greater than zero, that's the only interesting part. When the magnitude of h is greater than h critical, we've just got 1 point. When it's less than h critical, we've got 3 points. And then there's these sort of degenerate cases of where we've got just 2. So we could summarize this in a plot that we'll call a stability diagram. And so we're just summarizing the number of fixed points right now. It's not exactly clear why it's called a stability diagram, because it's not going to tell us the stability just yet. But that's its name. So I'll plot it this way. This is R, and this is H, 0, and then we've got 0, negative 1, 1, something like that. Out of 0, 0, there's these two curves. This is HCR and negative HCR. We're just plotting these curves and they'll meet, they actually meet tangentially at 0, 0 in the parameter space. And then we could summarize in this region, right? We've got 3 fixed points. And outside of that, we just have 1 fixed point. Maybe I'll say the region in yellow has 3 fixed points. It's fun to color these in. And then everything else in white is 1 fixed point. And then, of course, there's these kind of bifurcation curves. We have 2 fixed points. generally, we're going to be in the one fixed point region or the three fixed point region. We haven't made a plot like this before, right? Because both these are two parameters in the sense of these are things that we consider fixed when the dynamics go forward. And we can look at if we were to fix H and vary R, what do we get in terms of where the equilibrium point is? So if we fix H and vary R, we get figures from before when we looked at both the robustness of the pitchfork diagram and also just this discussion of feed in the rotating hoop with the imperfection. So from before, what do we have? We're going to do the typical bifurcation diagram where we just vary one parameter and then look at where our fixed points X star are for H equals zero, kind of the boring case, which just corresponds to one line in this parameter space diagram. We get things like this, we get the usual pitchfork, and let's say H not equals zero. In fact, I'll show the H greater than zero. There's R, there's X star, this curve goes up there, and below the R axis, there is a saddle node bifurcation. We could look at it the other way too. And that's what will kind of be new. If we fix, it means we're considering R as constant, and now we vary H, what do we get? We get for R less than equal to zero, there is H, there is X star. We'll get a curve that looks like that. These graphs look like an earlier graph just rotated, remember R greater than zero. What we'll get is something like this. It stops at a point, and then we get what looks like two saddle node bifurcations. There's another way to plot this, which might appeal to you. And this is what gives rise to the term cusp catastrophe. The cusp, this is a cusp up here. Two curves meeting tangentially, not transversely, but tangentially. That doesn't look catastrophic in and of itself. But you could also get a cusp if you take a piece of paper and like fold it over. And so that's what we're going to try to plot here. So this is just plotting these two things, but in terms of a surface. So maybe instead of calling this X, let's call this X star. So we have a surface of the equilibrium points. And of course, it's not single valued, right? So this surface gives the location of the fixed points as a function of the two parameters. In this case, it's a height, two parameters, R and H. You can kind of see where this cusp thing comes from. At the kind of fold in the paper, that's a cusp. And if you project down these lines coming off the edge, they become these curves that reveal the cusp. And it'd be cool if we could color this surface according to the stability, because the part that's kind of folded back would be unstable. And the other two are stable. And that's what leads to this terminology of the cusp catastrophe. Because if we were, let's say, at this system state, and then we varied this, let's say we're changing H only. Then as we change H, because this top surface is stable, as we vary H, we'll be at this nice stable state that changes continuously. And then when we get to this cliff, we jump down and now we're on this surface. So we had a discontinuous jump as we varied that parameter. And that's where the whole catastrophe comes in, because this could have disastrous consequences depending on the system. So if this was like the equilibrium of a bridge or a building, maybe down here is a pile of rubble, that would be catastrophic. That's where the term comes from. And it was developed in the 1970s. People often don't speak of catastrophe theory anymore, but now you at least know where it comes from. You know, it's kind of related to the just changes in the pitchfork bifurcation. This can happen. What makes this even more catastrophic? Let's say the top surface was a desired state of a system and you didn't know, but H was changing to the point that, you had this discontinuous change to an undesirable state. You're like, well, I'm going to do my best to change H back. If you were to reverse course you're stuck on this lower undesirable state until you could reach this critical value, in which case you would jump up. That's a problem. I don't know, melodramatic, maybe to call it a catastrophe, but that's what it's called. If you want some other views of this, if I took a vertical slice of this, I would get these curves up here. Things look like this. Generally, it would look like the one on the right, and only at h equals zero would I get something like this. And if I were to take other slices at constant r, I would get things that look like this. The surface kind of summarizes it. This shows a cusp catastrophe. So it's showing the cusp surface in yellow and then the sort of jumping down. It's just sort of showing a vertical line, really. This looks like somebody took a piece of cloth that had some extra slack in it and just sort of folded it over. And then this is another video made by Professor Grist, who's an Illinois mathematics professor. And this shows the surface. This one's oriented differently, but you can see kind of constant contours. And this shows the surface sort of sliding through one way or the other way. So that's cool.